Okay, I want to talk about the bad design argument, or you could call it the argument from bad design. This is the argument that says that actually, if you look at life in detail, although if you stand back and say, oh, there's a lot of things about life that look as though it was intelligently designed, if you look at the details, you can see hints that it wasn't, in fact, intelligently designed, that it was cobbled together by something that couldn't see what it was trying to make. And you can see why, if you think that life was put together by a blind watchmaker, not an intelligent watchmaker, you would want to argue this way. You'd want to say that, yes, there are things about life that look as though they were designed beautifully put together. They work as though an engineer put them together. But if you look at details, because an engineer didn't actually put these things together, you're going to see hints of that. You're going to see signs of that. So there's a reason that people who are taking the materialist view of life, the Darwinist view of life, are going to want to argue that although natural selection and random mutation have produced marvels, if you look at them closely, you'll see that they're not exactly the sort of marvel you would get if an intelligent designer made them. Now, there's two different strands of this kind of argument. One is really the broken design argument, and the other is the inept or incompetent design argument. So one looks at things like cancer and birth defects, all kinds of things that go wrong that cause death and misery, and asks whether a designing intelligence, whether God would have made life so that all of these things go wrong. And the other one says that actually the details of life suggest that something other than an intelligence put it together, that there's ineptness or strangeness in the design that no designer would have used. There are really two different arguments, and this one over here, the one that argues that there's broken things and calls into question God's motives, if you will, for making life, that's a different argument, because it's not actually arguing that God didn't make life or that life wasn't intelligently designed. It's just calling into question motives or calling into question why it would look like this if he did make it. The other one is more correct as an argument against, or it's more plausible, at least superficially, as an argument against intelligent design, because it's saying, if you look at the details of the design itself, it shows evidence of not having been done by someone who was thinking about what he was doing. So let's consider this argument. And I have to say that in my, the examples of this argument that I've seen, and there are a large number of them, they never seem to be very high quality arguments. It's as though people are desperate to find things that they can throw out and say, well, what about this? And it's as though everyone recognizes the weight of the argument against accidental life, and that's what we've been talking about for these lessons, is the many different strands of argument you can take, all of which show that life can't be an accident, it had to have been intelligently designed. I think people who don't want to go where the weight of that argument goes are going to desperately look for things that they can throw up as counterexamples, and that's why you have this bad design argument. Okay, so a famous person who's put forward arguments along these lines, and a lot of people have done this, but Neil deGrasse Tyson gave a lecture. I'm not sure when he gave this lecture, but if you go to YouTube and search for Neil deGrasse Tyson stupid design, you'll find a 5-minute video clip from a lecture, and he throws up on the screen there stupid design, and he talks for about 5 minutes on what he thinks are the key examples of stupid design. There's too many of them for me to respond to all of them, but I wanted to pick out a couple of them just to give you a flavor of how easy it is to refute or to dismiss these arguments. The first thing, if you look at the video, to notice is he's not talking as a philosopher to a bunch of philosophers. He's not being a thinking person who's trying to convince other critical thinking people. He's instead being more a stand-up comedian delivering a stand-up comedy routine to a bunch of people who clap and enjoy his viewpoint. So he's speaking to his own choir, speaking to his own constituents. He's not really trying to convince, he's trying to entertain. And the way he speaks comes across that way. And that signals to you, if you look at the video, that probably this isn't going to be the most compelling intellectual content. One of the first things that he says is that if you put life almost anywhere within the volume of this universe, it would die instantly. Okay, and of course that's true. If you put us in outer space, we would suffocate. If you put us in the middle of the sun, we'd burn to death. If you put us in the middle of the earth, we'd be crushed and burned to death. Of course that's true, but it's not a very compelling argument. He wants to say that because most of the volume of the universe is not conducive to life, therefore you can't say that this universe was designed for life. But you could apply that logic equally to, say, a roller coaster and say that if you put humans most places on the structure of a roller coaster, it would be very dangerous for them and they could very likely die. And therefore, roller coasters were not designed for humans. But that's complete nonsense. They were designed for humans, and they were designed for humans to be in the seat with the harness down to hold them in. All the rest of the structure is for the purpose of entertaining humans, and it is designed for the humans to be in one particular place, a very small fraction of the total places within the structure of the roller coaster. And yet, it was designed for humans. So that's a simple counterexample that shows how silly the logic is. Another argument that Tyson puts forward in this five-minute video, and one that he claims is his favorite argument, is the fact that we eat and drink and breathe and speak through one opening, the mouth. And he claims that this is an example of stupid design because it's just asking for us to choke. The fact that we eat and breathe through the same opening means we could get food lodged in the throat, in the trachea, and we could choke to death, and indeed, some people do choke to death. So this has caused death, and he says it's an obvious example of something that an intelligent designer wouldn't do. He says, I'm not asking for much. If you look at porpoises, if you look at dolphins, they've got a blowhole that they breathe through, and they eat through a different opening. So they have two different openings, so it can be done. Why wouldn't an intelligent designer have done this with us? Okay, and for that reason, he says, that tells you that we weren't intelligently designed. But it's really a very silly argument. Let's think about this a little more carefully than he did. What are the anatomical structures that we use to eat? It's the lips, it's the teeth, it's the palate, and the tongue. Those are all well-designed for eating, right? But what are the anatomical structures that we use for speaking? It's the very same structures. It's the lips, it's the teeth, it's the palate, it's the tongue. The very same structures that are used for eating are used for speaking. And speaking requires air. We have to breathe to speak. We're expelling air as we speak. So this is actually an example of elegant design. Designers, if you go and talk to design engineers, it's considered to be very elegant design if you can use the same structures for two different purposes. And this is an excellent example of that. We speak and we eat with the very same structures, and we do so very elegantly. And in fact, if you look at causes of death among humans in America, there are statistics on this. Choking actually isn't in the top 10 causes of death. Number 10, of course, cancer and heart disease are the top two and have been for a long time. Number 10 is suicide, okay? So think about what a designer could have done if the main goal were to prevent death. The designer could have not given us a mind, because it's a mind gone wrong, a mind gone depressed that leads to suicide. So that gives you an idea for the complexity of actual design problems that deGrasse Tyson is just glossing over here. Why would God have made us without minds, as though the only goal were to keep us from dying? Evidently, that wasn't the only goal. Evidently, he has higher goals, and a mind giving us minds is an important part of the higher goal, and there is a cost to that. And some minds go wrong, and some minds kill others, and some minds kill themselves. Evidently, it was not the designer's purpose to prevent that from happening. Evidently, there's a higher purpose, and a mind is important for that. So that brings up a key aspect of design that deGrasse Tyson has glossed over, and that most of these arguments gloss over, and that is, design always involves the weighing of multiple objectives, and it always involves trade-offs, right? If you look at a smartphone, people and smartphone sizes have gone up and down, right? Because people, on the one hand, want them to be small enough to put in their pocket and to be easy to carry around. On the other hand, they want them to be large enough to have enough screen real estate that you can see a lot on the screen. And you can't have both, ultimately. You can't have a large screen and a small size that fits in your pocket. So there's a trade-off. And you've seen smartphone sizes go up and down because they're exploring the sweet spot in this trade-off. But there is a trade-off. And that's a very common theme in design. You have multiple objectives, there's trade-offs, and you need to hit a sweet spot where you're accomplishing multiple things well, given those trade-offs. completely ignored and completely glossed over by deGrasse Tyson when he talks about, you know, the problem of choking causing death. A lot of things that are a part of us are going to cause risks and are going to cause death. Evidently, the designer was willing to make us that way, and evidently that fits within his higher purpose. So that brings up an even larger sort of philosophical level of critique of the bad design argument. And that is, if we look at examples where people are competent critics of spheres of human activity, what do we see? If you watch the Olympics and you watch gymnastics, who are those judges? Are those nobodies who don't know anything about gymnastics, or are they former gymnasts and former gymnastic coaches who have lived gymnastics for decades and decades, and they know exactly what they need to be looking for when they're judging someone in gymnastics? Of course, they're experts. They have walked gymnastics for decades before they would sit as a judge looking at other people doing gymnastics. So compare that to someone like deGrasse Tyson weighing in on whether the design of life is competent or not. What has deGrasse Tyson designed, and is there anything that he has designed that he would compare to life? I haven't looked through the patent registry. I'm not sure if he's patented anything. I'm very sure of this. He has never made anything that remotely compares to life. If that's the case, then why would he think that he is in a position to offer an intelligent critique of life? Why would he be a judge of life? There isn't anyone who really is qualified to sit in that position. There isn't anyone that God would have tapped on the shoulder when he's thinking about how he's going to design things. Say, what do you think about this, Neil? Do you think this looks like a good design for a dragonfly? I don't think so. I don't think God needed Neil's input on that. So when people weigh in like this, they're really showing themselves to be, in a sense, foolish, that they're standing in judgment over something that they're just simply not competent to judge. That's the most, I think, the most profound critique of this whole argument. And it's something that you can say in response to the argument. You don't have to follow all of these and try to find out what's wrong with them, because it gets exhausting after a while. Instead, you can say, what have you made that you think qualifies you to critique life?